Ivanovich. He will speak about how many colors are needed to color every pentagon of a graph in 5 colors. So this is a topic which is not that much known. This is a UM on-theorem program. And the interesting point in this is that it is connected to very many different important things. So, and actually we started many, many years ago, of course, with Paul Ehrlich, and now I return to this topic and still have to write up old paper with Ehrlich. Okay, so the aim of this lecture, as you see, is to speak about, to tell something about these dual anti-Ramsey problems and their connections to other things. So there are the two type extremal problems, supersaturated problems, anti-Ramsey problems, and dual anti-Ramsey problems. And actually many of those are quite well known, the two type, the supersaturated anti-Ramseys, and Burr, Erdős, Sós, and Graham wrote two papers and Peter Funk about these dual anti-Ramsey problems, but otherwise there are not too many results on that as far as I see. So I just make a short introduction to the notation. So of course, two-arm graph on n vertices and p classes means that n vertices are distributed in p classes as evenly as possible, and two points are joined if and only if they belong to different classes. And the general question in extremal graph, in two-arm type extremal problems, is that given a family of forbidden graphs, how many edges can a graph GN have if it doesn't contain any graph from L, script L, any L from script L? The maximum will be denoted by XNL. And those graphs which achieve their maximum, that means they don't contain any subgraph from this forbidden class. Those are the extremal graphs. And I have to emphasize here that containment here is not necessarily induced containment. So Tulan proved the first such, not really, because Anders proved the first such type. So we could go back to Montel, and then came Anders in 1938, and then Tulan in 1941. And Tulan asked the right problems, right questions, and therefore, after Tulan, a whole theory emerged. This is now one of the largest sub-areas of graph theory. So the asymptotic solution of such an extremal problem can easily be obtained if you know the Erdős-Thom theorem. Then Erdős and I observed that this chromatic, the minimum chromatic number in the forbidden family decides the asymptotic number this extremal problem, and the asymptotic structure is also quite well defined by this parameter. So P is here the minimum chromatic number in the family of forbidden graphs. The structure stability means that if you take two extremal problems where this minimum the subchromatic number P, which is the minimum number of chromatic number minus 1, for two families is the same, then basically the extremal graphs are the same. They are the same as in Tulan's theorem. That means that they are almost a Tulan graph. Now I'm jumping ahead, and I am telling what is a dual anti-Ramsey problem, just to give a direction of this lecture. Assume that you have a graph which has n square over 4 plus 1 edges. Now n square over 4 plus 1 is an extremal number for C5. That means that if a graph has this many edges and not too few vertices, then it has C5. And the question is, how many colors are needed to color the edges? When I'm speaking about edge coloring, I always when I'm speaking about coloring to the, it's always edge coloring. How many colors do you need as a minimum to five color each C5? So this is the basic question today. And of course, for different GN, this minimum number of color is different, and we are interested in the that very GN which where you can use the minimum number of chromatic number of colors. Of course, you can ask the same question for many other sample graphs. You pick an arbitrary graph, and you would ask if you have a graph GN on n vertices. Subscript is always here a number of vertices. So if GN is an n vertex graph, and it has a little bit more than the extremal number for L, here there is some extra k, it's a small number, then how many, the question is, how many colors do you need to color the edges of GN so that each copy of L in it has EL colors? So it is range of colors. All the colors of GN are different. So what are the the motivations? The next three slides we will speak about this. Here, we have to go, so three remarks. First of all, we have to be above the extremal number, because below the extremal number, maybe you don't have any copy of C5 or of the forbidden graph. Therefore, you simply can color this one color or HSH, and that's trivial. So nobody's interested in it. But the next remark is that for C5, which I have already told, that for C5, S over 4 is an extremal graph, the same as for the triangle. That means that n vertices are partitioned into two classes, and any vertex is connected to the any vertex in the other class. So this is the extremal number. And the color, the main theorem will be here, the central theorem, that if you have a graph with n square over 4 plus 1 edges, and you color its edges so that each C5 is 5 colored, then you have to use at least n half plus 3 colors. So this is the central issue we are running around this theorem. And here is a construction which shows that this is sharp. This is from the paper of Burr, Erdős, Sors, Graham. So do the following. Take a two-line graph on two classes and add one extra edge. This is xy. And then color it as follows. So x, the edge xy gets its own color. This is 0. Then you'd have a another color for the edges going out from x, those will be x tilde, and a third color going out from y, those will be y tilde, that those edges will have color y tilde, and then each other edge goes from a vertex from the bottom to the top, and it gets the index or the color corresponding to the bottom vertex. So that means that from uj, all the edges are here green, but generally they get the color J tilde. And here you can easily check that it doesn't contain any incorrectly colored pentagons. More precisely, all the pentagons have 5 colors. Why? Because all the pentagons contain this XY, so that is 0 colored, so that not used anywhere else. Then they have a color corresponding to x, a color corresponding to y, and then these two vertices are differently colored, so their pentagons are 5 colored. So these problems are coming from these two papers of Burr, Erdős, Graham, and Sors, and then Burr, Erdős from Graham and Sors. And these are coming from a computer science problem. So the original problem why they started investigating it was that Berkowitz wanted to solve some trade-off, time-space trade-off theorem for Turing machines. That means that if you have more space, then you can do something faster on a Turing machine. And specifically, he arrived at a combinatorial problem, which meant that he considered sequences, 0-1 sequences, where this was, they were counted mod 2, that means that he considered GF2 to the n, so those were n sequences of lengths n, and then he did this by A, and then he asked, how large an S can he have as a subset of the triples here if all the, these vectors x, y, z, if they are in S, then and then he assumes that x plus y plus z equals 0 mod 2. And another strange condition that if he takes 6 different vertices x, x prime, y prime, z, z prime, then these 3 elements belong to S, x prime, y, z, x, y prime, z, x, y, z prime, so this is excluded. So there do not exist such 6 vertices. When he asked this, I think that it was after Ruja's Samaridi theorem. I will explain more in detail the Ruja's Samaridi theorem. But that describes, but this theorem, these conditions are very similar to the condition of the Ruja-Samaridi theorem. And this is why it's not so surprising, but it's very nice that the solution of to this problem was given by using the Ruja-Samaridi theorem, which is very important in experimental graph theory. So what is the Ruja-Samaridi theorem? Slightly earlier, I think in 72, Brown, Erdős and Berasós asked the following question, a family of questions. You have two parameters K and L, and you consider 3 uniform hypergraphs where K vertices cannot define L triples. And the maximum number of triples in such a 3 uniform hypergraph, so that means in a 3 uniform hypergraph where k vertices cannot define L triples, this is denoted by F and KL. And these 3 authors proved a lot of results in this area, but they were stopped at one of some others, and the first question which they couldn't solve was the 6-3 problem. That means that how many triples can you have in a 3 uniform hypergraph if you don't have 6 points defining 3 triangles. If you go back to the previous slide, then you see that here you have something similar. You have a 3 uniform hypergraph and you cannot have 3 triangles on 6 points. So it's not so surprising that the authors of this previous paper arrived to at the conclusion that they should use Ruja-Samaridi theorem. So what is Ruja-Samaridi theorem? Ruja-Samaridi theorem says that Fn6c is little n squared. This is a highly non-trivial result. All n squared is easy, so the maximum would be n cubed. Big O n squared would be trivial. But little n square is one of the first applications of a simpler version of the regularity lemma. Actually, this was that very, and this is important today, this was that very paper where the triangle remover lemma was proved. It was hidden in that paper, but the triangle remover lemma, which said that if we have a sequence of graphs which contain little n cube copies of a triangle, then we can remove little n square edges from Gn to get a triangle-free graph. So this is one of the important results in that paper. This is a detour now, one of the many detours. For For ordinary graphs, Erdős and Rice conjectured that for any bipartite excluded graph, there is a rational alpha such that C1 times n to the alpha is a Lewis bound for extremal number of n L, but we assume that L contains this L, and C2 n to the alpha is an upper bound. The meaning of this is the following, that when we conjecture this, all the constructions were geometric constructions. And if you have used a geometric, algebraic geometric construction in this area, that means that you have surfaces, then you have dimensions, and then the dimension of the whole space divided by the, that divides the dimension of the neighborhood of a vertex. So in these geometric questions, you always get a rational alpha. So we had this conjecture, and there is a lower bound in the Ruja-Samarady problem due to Behrend. It's much earlier than the Ruja-Samarady theorem itself, and that proves that for a three-uniform hypergraph, our conjecture is not valid. So for three-uniform hypergraphs, it may happen that here 2 is an upper bound, n square is an upper bound, but too much because little n square is enough here, but the lower bound is not matching the upper bound. So for three-uniform hypergraphs, the rational exponent doesn't exist. Still, somehow, Verhoeven asked in connection with their problem that is it true that if you take an arbitrary Steiner triple system, S, then you can pick many subsets from it to get n to the 2 minus epsilon triples, so that no 6-point defines 3 triples. I just mentioned that somehow all these questions lead to many open questions, much more than solved questions. Now, in the paper of Burr, Erdős, Graham, and Sors, this line of the table, so they summarized the results in a much larger table, but these three lines were the important ones, and it said that the C5 is one of the most important subcases, that C5 is more complicated than the others, and actually they wrote it down that C5 seems to be much more complicated and poorly understood. And they gave some lower and upper bounds, and the upper bounds were, in different cases, upper bounds were by construction, and we use that, so in our paper with Erdős we use the same, that's a manuscript, not a published paper. And here I will sketch the proof of the lower bound. So again, a detour. Before these dual anti-Ramsey problems came, we defined the anti-Ramsey theorems. Actually, the term anti-Ramsey comes from Richard Rado, who used it for other things. And in the anti-Ramsey problem, you have a graph, a complete graph. You want to color its edges with many, many colors, but you ask how many colors can you have without having one copy of L, which is totally multicolored. Totally multicolored means that all the edges have different colors. So that means that we want to have many colors and at least one copy of total of rainbow colored copy of L, and in the dual case we try to use few colors and all the copies should be rainbow color. Here I'm just showing an example of the Ramsey, of the anti-Ramsey case. There is a trivial theorem or claim that if you color K and with at least n colors, then you have at least one three-colored triangle. This is what Billabood would call a coffee table, or a big coffee table.
Taylor problem. So it is very simple. The proof is as follows. You take from each color one edge, then you have a cycle which is multicolored, and all the because all the colors are different, because you get from each color just one edge, and take the shortest one. If it is longer than three, then you can add the diagonal, and either one side of it or the other side is still totally multicolored, and that's the proof of this observation. But what is strange, that as soon as from triangle you go to C4, then it's much, much more complicated. Actually, this was the first paper of Noga Aron which I have seen in my life. He used our methods, but still it was a non-trivial thing. And only much, much later, the general question was solved by Montalano, Ballesteros, Neumann-Lauer, and Campo. The problem with the anti-anthropo questions is that usually we use some of the colors very often and the others not so often, and therefore Erdős and Tuza made a perturbation where they didn't let to use some colors much more often, but I skipped this field. That's an interesting area, but let me skip it. So now let me get back to the dual anti-MC problems. As I said, in the anti-MC problems, determining the maximum number of colors without having a TMC copy of L. In the dual, we look for the minimum so that all the copies of L are totally multicolored. I'm just repeating here the two papers. And here is one thing that in the 4.1 theorem of the paper of Burr, Graham, and Schorsch gave the upper bound which I showed you, and the lower bound which was just linear times L. And this is where I will sketch a proof that the upper bound is the lower bound. This is just a construction which I showed, and here is the statement that whenever you have a graph on n square over 4 plus 1 edges, and you color each as edges so that each C5 is 5 color colored, then you have to use at least n half plus C colors. This is just a formal description of that, and here comes another theorem. So this construction which I showed here can be made a little bit more complicated. The original construction I showed means that for each vertex I have a permutation of colors down here, the same permutation, and you could choose different permutations and don't get these details, but what I'm saying is that there's a uniqueness theorem which says that if you take an arbitrary graph with n square over 4 plus 1 edges and you color n half plus 3 colors so that all the pentagons are 5 colored, then this can be only the slightly generalized coloring of what I described here. So all the colorings are very easy to describe. This is a uniqueness theorem. There is, of course, a general question that, as we saw, that in the ordinary extremal graph problems, the behavior of the extremal number depends primarily on the chromatic number. So the question here is, on what does the behavior of this high S n alpha S square L, what is the meaning of this? This is the answer to the general question. So This says that strong chromatic number of a graph on n vertices which has alpha n square edges and doesn't and all the copies of L are well colored. All the edges of each copy of L has a different color. So one of the theorems says, and this is interesting, that if you have a graph in which you have two strongly independent edges. Now, what does it mean that strongly independent? Independent means that they don't have a common vertex, but strongly independent means that these edges are missing here too. This is totally independent, and it says that if you have for wind graph which does contain strongly independent edges, it behaves one way, and if it doesn't contain, it behaves a different way. So that means, for example, that there is a strong difference between C5 and C7, because C7 has two strongly independent edges and C5 doesn't have. But there on the table you see the bipartite version of this statement, which I just formulated. And now I'm showing a few constructions. This is a very, very complicated construction. It seems to be complicated, and it is not so complicated. I'm telling in the next pictures what does it say. It says the following, it says the following thing. Partition n vertices into two equal parts. If you want to, so you have n squared, okay. You have n squared over 4 plus k edges. Now, if k equals l choose 2, then it is simple. Then the best thing is to put a complete graph on l vertices into the first class and independent vertices in the other class, and then make a coloring which is similar to the one which I showed, but there were just two vertices connected. Here you have a complete graph. Now all these will have different colors, so that means that it will have L choose two different colors. All these colors will depend only on the upper vertex, all these colors on the lower vertex. So this is a one-sided construction, because you have horizontal edges, you have X edges only in the upper class, you don't have edges inside of the second class. Here is another type of construction. Basically here you have the same n square over 4 plus 3 edges. Here you have two X edges, here you have one, and this can be as good as this one. Okay. So here is a theorem that if you have n square over 4 plus k edges, where k equals h choose 2, then this optimum in the problem is h plus 1 times n over 2 plus k. This chi s, what it stands for, so this means that strong chromatic number, if you have a graph on n vertices, then the copies of the pentagons in it form a hypergraph. And this hypergraph has a strong chromatic number, and this is why the authors use this chi s, saying that strong chromatic number. You don't have to really think about hypergraphs and about strong chromatic number, but this is what they Now, if you have this k between two h choose two numbers, then it's more complicated, but because of monotonicity, this theorem gives here a pretty good estimate. How do we prove just the simplest theorem? The simplest theorem is that if you have a graph, so it says that if you have a graph GN with S square over 4 plus K plus 1 edge plus 1 edge, then you have to use at least N half plus 3 colors. So it is a stability method, and even just to speak about stability would take up all my time. By the way, how much time do I have? I didn't check it when I started.
You have 10 more minutes.
Yeah, okay, good. It's more than enough. So stability means that first of all we have an arbitrary graph, and we want to prove that for this arbitrary graph you can if you can color it so that with some number of colors, that each pentagon has five colors, then this graph, and you use only something roughly n half plus a small number of colors, then you have to use, then this graph has to be very similar to the Turan graph. So this is what we want to get. And for that, one has to use a stability theorem, either through using the regularity lemma or using a more elementary lemma of Robbins and myself. This is connected to the supersaturated theorems. Baylor had quite nice results in this area. Originally, Moon and Moser had results in this. And we proved the following theorem. Now, this is again, in this box, a theorem which seemed to be complicated, but it says the following in human language. Just it is for arbitrary large complete graphs, but it says the following. Now I'm speaking only about the case of triangles. It says that if you have a Turan graph and add one edge, then this one edge yields you k times n half triangles. So you will get, for each edge here, if you add an edge, you get k times n half triangles. That means that if you add here t edges to this one, then you get, sorry, so if you add k edge to this, then you, okay, I misstated. So if you add here k edges, then you get k times n half triangles. And this theorem said that if you have a graph which has k times n half triangles, or not much more triangles, with that many number of edges, not more than say 1,000 times this many, so the number of triangles is less than 1,000 times k times n half, then it has to be very similar to the Turan graph on two classes. So this is what it says. Why? Because it says that, assume that a graph has here, n is missing, a graph has as many edges as the Turan graph, plus k edges, this k are different here. No, not really. And then you count how many copies of kp it has. Now, the Turan graph has this many complete graphs on p vertices, and each extra edge has constant times n to the p minus 2 complete graphs. So if you add one edge, then you will have constant times n to the p minus 2. If you add k edges, then you will have this many. And this theorem says that if you don't have more than this one, it's an arbitrary much larger, see, then you can change the original graph into a Turan graph with changing only a few edges. So this is the theorem. And then come several steps, but how is it connected to Zeruja-Semeredi? It is connected to Zeruja-Semeredi as follows. Here you have the graph. Now I am stating that in our critical case, the graph has only little n cube, little n cube triangles. So again, the statement is that in the case which we want to consider, the graph has only little n cube triangles. Why? Because if you have more than, if you have constant times n cube triangles, then you have a vertex which has constant times n square edges. So you will have here constant times n square edges. If you have here constant times n square edges, then if all the pentagons are five colored, then all the three edge paths, all the p4s, are here three colored. So we use the condition that all the pentagons are five-colored by concluding that all the, in the neighborhood order, P4s are three-colored. But that was already known by Burr, by Burr and Graham and Erdős and Sors that under this condition you have to have much more colors than linear number. So if you have this condition here, then dividing the number of colors here by n, that will go to infinity. So this is excluded. That means that all the vertices have little n square edges. All the neighborhoods have little n square edges. All the whole graph has little n cube triangles. And therefore, using this theorem, you get that you can change little n square edges in the graph to get complete bipartite time graph. And then you are done with that. This is a more detailed sketch of this proof. And there are some open questions. There are some results on C7, which is very complicated. And one question is it true that the extreme construction for any n square over 4 plus a small k is a product type, which means in my language, I'm saying that in my language, because many people use another, so they call it joint. Okay. Is it true that all the edges echo in the extremal case, all the edges from the top to the bottom are in the graph? And that's not true. There are cases when you can construct, you can have constructions where some edges in one of the optimal constructions is missing. I don't know any case where in all the optimal constructions there is a missing edge between the two classes. Another thing is that, and then I will finish, that there is a strange coloring number here that means that you want to edge color a graph Gn, sorry, a graph, here is a graph, you want to edge color so that the strongly independent edges may have the same color, but otherwise they have to have different colors. So this is a chromatic number, and the strange thing about it is that it is not monotonic. So in some sense, this is a very, very strange, and you could say disgusting coloring, I don't know. Okay, I stop here, thank you.
How about questions and comments this time?
Who is that? Bert, Birk, Birka?
Yeah, Bert mondtam, nem Birkát.
No, but you wrote
it. The Birk, the reference.
No, that Birkhäuser. So that Turan, when Turan died, that means a reference I wrote, I think, but we could. So I, of course, I always misspell things, so you may be right. But Birkhäuser was the publisher who published the study.
You wrote Love, Steam,
Birk. Yeah, because this is Lovas Simonovic in the Birkhäuser volume.
Obvious.
I actually. But you know, because if it were a person, then it would be in the first place, yeah?
No.
It re-proved it 2 years later.
So, okay, so I usually say that the names like Bach, Führerdi, I say Führer, and then I put it there that I say Wapnik. And then Wapnik is not an author, but that means that this is my method, and the problem was that here on the slides, I wanted to have references which we don't use mostly. And how can I do? I used the same references which I used in LaTeX.
What was your question about the product? If you go back one
transition. Yeah.
No, one more.
No, this is the last one, and.
No, go back. That's it.
Yeah.
What is this product extremography? Can you always get a product extremography?
The product I always mean that a Turan graph plus something. So I call product which you call chuboy.
Which is not a product.
No, no, for me the problem is a product, because if you take the extremal problem for the octahedron, then that's a product for me of the C4 and of the P3. So here, this means, the meaning of this is that the extremal graph, so if you take any graph which has, which you can color with minimum number of colors, so that...
So can you state this problem precisely and not briefly, so that it...
Yeah, the question is, take an arbitrary graph...
C5, C5 problem.
Yeah, just C5. Otherwise, and just n square over n square over 4 plus a small number k, but it is important that k is very small. Then the question is, can you always find an optimal graph, that means a graph which you can color with minimum number of colors, so that and so on, where all the edges between the two classes, where you have two classes of approximately n half vertices and all the edges joining them are there. This is what I call product.
So contains a complete bipartite graph, very large
complete. It is a complete bipartite graph plus
some.
In your language, a spanning complete bipartite. Not only that it contains a complete bipartite, a spanning complete bipartite.
With ML n square over 4 inches.
Yes.
Well, okay, now let us thank all the speakers.